Thank you, if you please. Be seated. Thank you for coming here. This is really a big day for the museum, I think for Greenville, Dark County, and this part of the country. I'm Clay Johnson, I'm the director of the museum here, and this is a Veterans Day program, and as a result, I'm going to go ahead and turn this over to some very special veterans that have been very instrumental in recognizing Douglas Dickey. And Dave, if you please come up, is one of the researchers that has really helped with the exhibit, and he's also a veteran. And I'm going to have him take over the ceremony.
Thank you, Clint. First of all, General Livingston, pleasure you're here. A man of 2nd Platoon, Charlie Company, 1-4 Marines, other veterans, friends, family, especially the Dickey family. Thank you for coming. I know this means a lot to all of us. I first got involved with this when I was an intern at Wright State going through a master's of public history to learn how to work in a museum. And this was where I did my internship. And so I saw the exhibits up here and I was talking, and Clay told me, you know, if we could get a Medal of Honor, and we're working on it to really redo the Dickey exhibit. And then when we actually got the medal, and we'll describe that, it was the spark that lit it, and that's how we made this happen. The actual exhibit was an ideal I had in my mind and sketched out on a piece of paper. And Dustin Neely, in the back of the room, that a lot of people know, is the master craftsman, photoshopper, video splicer that made this rough sketch of an ideal I had turn into what you see here. And it's just unbelievable what he did. And Norman, Doug's brother, sent me a package. And within that package was a videotape. And I knew that videotape probably only had one play left in it. And I wanted to put it in the machine and watch it. But I said, no, I'm going to get this to Dustin. So if it only has one play, we make a copy of it, that play. And so Dustin took the tape, and I got an email that night, and I wanted to read it. And he wrote, as I sit here watching this, I am watching and recording the video for the first time. Tears streaming down my face. I've stopped it twice because it's so powerful. The most personal and powerful documentary I have ever seen. If this does not bring you to tears, you are not a patriot and possibly have no soul. And that's exactly what this video we're going to see is. And it's very, very powerful. I'd also like to introduce the Color Guard, Sergeant Byers, and this unit is the unit that provided the Color Guard for Doug's memorial service, and this unit provided the Color Guard for the 30th anniversary reunion of the platoon. So this unit has quite a history with you all up here too. General Livingston, I read his book before he came in so I could not look so stupid when I was talking to him. And the graphics in his book matched the map that Norman had sent me. And I did not put the pieces together until then, but General Livingston and Doug were fighting on the same map sheet, which is about 20 kilometers by 20 kilometer area. And both of their battles were on the same map, and that was just amazing when I put those pieces together. But also on that video, they had their 30th reunion. And just this last year, we had our 30th reunion of those of us who parachuted into Grenada with the Ranger Battalion. And I was looking at that reunion video and thinking, I just had my 30th reunion. That's me now. And so it's a pleasure to see you guys here again. And I am going to quit talking and get this rolling. And I want you to see the video that will be playing on the monitor in the exhibit while the exhibit's going.
Douglas Dickey, a 20-year-old leatherneck from Rossburg, Ohio, was killed when he smothered an exploding enemy hand grenade with his own body to save a group of fellow Marines. For this selfless heroism, Private First Class Dickey was awarded the Medal of Honor, posthumously, in recognition of his conspicuous gallantry and intrepidity above and beyond the call of duty. The presentation ceremony took place in Washington, D.C., at the historic Marine Barracks on a brisk and sunswept April morning. Mr. and Mrs. Harold E. Dickey and three other sons arrived at 8th and I to receive the coveted medal from Secretary of the Navy Paul R. Ignatius. General Leonard F. Chapman, Marine Corps Commandant, accompanied Mr. Ignatius and later read the Medal of Honor citation. Private First Class Dickey died March 26, 1967, during a fierce firefight on Operation Beacon Hill 1 in Quang Tri Province. His unit, the 2nd Platoon of C Company, 1st Battalion, 4th Marines, was battling the enemy at close range in dense jungle near the hamlet of Joan. Heavy communist machine gun and small arms fire repeatedly raked the Marines, finally pinning them down. When a platoon radio man was hit and wounded, PFC Dickey was called up to replace him. Just as Dickey reached the beleaguered group of five Marines, he heard a sudden shattering cry, "Grenade!" An enemy hand grenade had dropped into the exposed group, which included two men already wounded and the platoon commander. Then, as the Medal of Honor citation recounts, fully realizing the inevitable result of his actions, Private First Class Dickey, in a final valiant act, quickly and unhesitatingly threw himself upon the deadly grenade, absorbing with his own body the full and complete impact of the explosion. One of Dickey's comrades reprieved by this act recalled vividly that Dickey had given him one short glance before lunging forward to deliberately cover the grenade with his body. After the blue coats and billowing flag had passed in review, Mr. and Mrs. Dickey stood together to accept the nation's highest honor on behalf of their son.
The Dickey family lives here. 20 acres surround the barn and the house. Mr. and Mrs. Dickey live in the house along with two of their three sons. And in the house, there are some pictures of Douglas. His graduation picture, Douglas was an average student, but teachers remember the quality of his character. From all accounts, he was an unusual boy. Less than a year after graduation, he was in the Marine Corps. At his high school in Ansonia, Douglas managed the basketball team. He played football, too. Friends remember him not as a great player, but as a kid with plenty of spunk. In Rossburg, the morning mist is thick and hugs the earth. The school bus, it's the same one Douglas used to take, drives slowly through the mist on rural Route 1. All along the way, the bus stops to pick up children who knew Douglas or who have brothers and sisters who went to school with him. Dennis remembered Douglas.
Most unforgettable, I believe, is the way he never lost his temper, hardly. Whenever he'd done something wrong, he never got mad. He'd just do it over until he'd done it right. And he could keep his head. And I remember I always liked athletics, and he was fond of athletics. And he used to teach me great many things.
Douglas graduated from Ansonia High School in 1965. His class book said that the only thing he disliked was sad people. Last week, they sat and talked about the kind of friend he was.
Describe what you value most about your friendship with Doug.
Well, he was, since we were 6 years old, he was my neighbor down the road. And I'll have to say, of all the years I've known him since then, I've never seen him angry once. Not really angry, ever. And that, can reflect back on how easy it was and what a fine man he was to get along with.
He was a quiet boy. Had a lot in common, liked to do a lot of the same things. He was just a buddy, a real good friend.
Douglas was deeply religious. His Sunday school teacher at the Methodist church he attended told us that Douglas was a leader in the class, a boy who read the Bible and tried to live by its teachings.
Well, Doug was a little unusual for a young man, and his feelings ever since I known him, which I knew him ever since he was born, but in the church and his church affiliations, he had a little more, I'd say, on the ball for God than probably most any other child that I was ever around in this church. I mean, not because he's gone, but that was the way he lived. He was had a concern for, deep concern for religion. And I remember one time in our Sunday school class that he, we brought up the subject. I said, now, I want to relate one thing to you boys and girls, that friends are hard to come by. In the time of trial, they don't always add up to what you might think. I says, in the Bible somewhere it's written that a man that gives his life for a friend, greater love hath no man shown than gave his life for a friend. Doug says, I believe I do that. I remember that distinctly.
His mother knew him best, and we talked to her about him.
Mrs. Dickey, what kind of a son was Douglas?
Well, he's a little hard to describe. Very affectionate. And always complimentary. Thoughtful. Considerate. And just the kind of a son that any mother would cherish. He was so unselfish with his everything he did. And so this was always, I think he felt a little more responsibility by having three younger brothers. And he helped me a great deal. So,
This is a tough question, Mrs. Dickey. How do you justify losing Douglas in Vietnam?
That is a very difficult question. He volunteered for service, and he also volunteered to give his life to save his friends. And I can feel no bitterness. Since he made this choice himself, he sacrificed himself to save his friends. How could I be bitter about that? He fully realized what he was doing, I think. And, I have had word from the boys who were with him, and he actually just gave them a quick glance and dived on that grenade. It was, I don't know, it hurt me a great deal to lose him, but I can't feel bitter. There's so many people die for no reason at all, and this was a definite reason.
Thank you, and I think you all can see how powerful that really was, and it was amazing that I could find some actual footage of the operation in the Marine Corps archives. But I do have to thank Norman and Dennis for providing the majority of the artifacts that made this exhibit happen. And I know I was probably a little gleeful at finding the perfect artifact, and boy, this is going to make the exhibit, and not being cognizant that this was your brother and this was your life, and it's more than just an artifact to you guys. So I hope I didn't do too much of that. And with that, I would like to introduce Lieutenant Colonel retired Tom McKinney, who was instrumental in getting the medal for the museum here, and I'd like you all to hear his story.
Brain-damaged old men are easily moved to tears, and I am one. And I'll do my best. The reunion group that I've just come to call the group began to meet with the Dickey family soon after Doug's death, soon after they returned from Vietnam. And they've been faithfully coming to reunions here to encourage the family and do whatever they could to support it, just to commemorate the memory of Doug, and not just the sacrifice he made as a Marine, but the kind of human being he was. In my experience, he may be unique, and I've never met the boy. But often when I say somebody was a good boy, I'll usually suffix it with, if there is such a thing. In his case, no suffix is needed. I believe he was a genuinely good boy. I counted up here today, and there are only three members of the group, plus five members of Doug's platoon. And one of the surviving members of the reunion group, and a key member, is Colonel Bob, and I wish he would, not Bob, Dave Rumsey. Dave, I'd like for you to come up here, please. The company commander, whom they all called the skipper, lived to see this day, almost. He died 9 days ago. He was in bad health, and we knew that he wouldn't be able to come. He knew that he wouldn't be able to come, but we were going to provide a live feed for him to see it and hear it as it happened. And he didn't live quite long enough. And I asked Bob to come and bring a picture, I mean Dave, excuse me, to come and bring a picture of Bob. And I'm going to quote Dave in a minute. And I won't call him Bob then. I would like for him. Bob asked him recently to speak briefly for him because he couldn't be here himself. Colonel Dave Rumsey, a survivor of 1-4 in that operation and a close friend of everybody here.
All right, thanks, Tom. I'll admit to having the same affliction. I'm an old man, and I sometimes tear up a bit.
Hold that up, if you will, so they can see it. And we'll put this over here somewhere where you can get a closer look at Bob.
Bob Kelly was a captain. He had a company of about 150 to 200 men. He led us through some very difficult times. And he did call me up. Actually, I called him, I guess, on this particular occasion, but he just indicated he was sure he wouldn't be able to make it here and asked if I would say a few words on his behalf. I would have been here anyway, but I'm always glad to say a few words on Bob Kelly's behalf. He was a good man that led us through some very difficult times. I was technically his XO, the number two guy in the company, but for whatever reason, Bob demoted me. I called him skipper or captain, but he demoted me to the weapons platoon, and I went in Vietnam with the weapons platoon. And then, when one of our platoon leaders lost his life, I took that platoon. I didn't last much longer myself, getting medevac before Douglas met his end. But let me start out by saying this. Bob Kelly did pass away on Election Day, November 4th. He was a good man. We all loved him, and he loved all of his Marines. And we're counting Doc Long as one of our Marines. Before I go into a little bit more detail about that, I want to thank Dr. Clay Johnson, the director here at the Garst Museum, Dave Mangus and Dustin Neely, who did a lot of work on this exhibit, Lieutenant Colonel Tom McKinney for coming here and seeing the need to upgrade that exhibit, to Major General Livingston, who I understand will be our guest speaker, for all coming here to honor Doug Dickey. And most important, I want to thank the Dickey family, particularly Doug's mom and dad, Harold and Leona. But we have Vera here, we have Dennis here, and we have Norman here, all from the Dickey family. Just based on what I know of Doug and what I know from having met with the family over the time, they're just a wonderful, wonderful family. I want to now introduce to you the people that are present from Charlie 1-4 back in 1967, in no particular order here. First, Jerry Ejack. Jerry was in the 2nd Platoon. Turn around, Jerry, now so everybody can see your pretty face. Now, I meant to check on this, but I didn't. But I think everybody here was wounded, at least. Jerry was, pretty seriously. Larry Lawson and his wife, Kathy. My apologies. We call him Chooch, and it's because his name is Lionel, and then I call him Larry. We had about 5 or 6 Larrys.
I've been called a lot worse by him. Let me tell you.
Chooch, sorry, Lionel. And his wife, Kathy, is sitting next to him. I guess she doesn't want to stand up. Okay, we have Larry Alley. He was also the 2nd Platoon, and his wife, Judy. Next, we have Stephanie Szymanski. Stephanie is the daughter of the 2nd Platoon Sergeant. He was killed in action, I think, 2 days before Doug. The pretty blonde there is my wife, Michelle. She can stand if she wants. She is the daughter of a Marine, Korean-era Marine. And last but not least, well, actually, let me mention one other person first. Lieutenant Colonel John Lang, retired Marine. He was not with us at that time. He's way too young for us old men. But he's been writing a book, and he's been working with the Dickey family, and he's working on this book, and I can't wait to see it when it comes out. I think it's getting close. And then last but not least is Doc Long, Hospitalman Long. The Marines that go out into combat usually have two corpsmen. They're technically in the Navy, but they're Marines as far as I'm concerned, that go out with us. And they have the poor souls that have to go out and drag back the injured and the wounded and try and treat them and get them taken care of. So, Doc, thanks. All right, a few brief words from then Captain Kelly. He retired as a Lieutenant Colonel. But he's proud to have served, as I believe we all are proud to have served. He's extremely proud of his Marines. I believe that his Marines loved him in the bromance kind of way, and I know he loved his Marines. Douglas Dickey is, frankly, a an example of how all the Marines were. They were, all of us were, I think, were willing to do everything we could to help the others that we were serving with and next to. So our skipper had passed on the word Semper Fi to everyone here, and I'll pass that on his behalf. And that's all I have. Thank you very much for bearing with me.
Dave, also known as Bob. Dave could have gone on and said that Doc Long is the only living survivor of those who were in that crater. He's the last one left on Earth who was there. And I thought, stand up again, will you, Doc? He's a...
Probably add a little bit to that. I got wounded about 2 days before this happened, maybe one day before. And the wounds weren't too serious. I was hell lifted to a ship offshore and got patched up.
Repeat yourself, please.
All right. I thought I was talking loud enough for everybody to hear me. But in any event, I got wounded and hell lifted to a ship. I was there, I don't know, 3 weeks, not too much. I got brought back to the company. By then, a lot of this activity had come to a halt. And since I was, as I said, technically the executive officer, and since I still had some stitches, I started doing some desk work for a change. And I interviewed the Marines that were involved in this episode with Doug Dickey. And I had thoughts of becoming a lawyer at the time. And I figured, well, I better do this right. And so I wanted to make sure it was clear that Doug didn't just happen to trip and fall, that this was a deliberate act. Doc Long was the guy that really put that together for me. I had I took the statements from all of them, had them kind of transcribed, brought them back to them to sign. And what Doc said was, to me, most telling. That when the grenade came in, it was all, there was, I mean, this all happened in just an instant, but it was, oh my God. And then Doug took a quick look at the others, particularly at Doc, looked him right in the eye, and then jumped on the grenade. He had to know. He had to know.
Thank you, Doc. You know, Doc is wearing his uniform as a member of the Marine Corps League. I refused to join the Marine Corps League for many, many years because they wouldn't take an FMF corpsman. And as far as those of us who have served with them, especially in combat, are concerned, they're just as much Marines as we are. In fact, in a way more, because when a shot and shell are flying and there's somebody out there badly hurt, they go automatically. We go, we might get a medal for it. It's their job to go. And God bless all combat FMF corpsmen. When one walks in the room, I stand up. Now, I've been asked to tell you how I came to be involved in this and what a wonderful consummation this is to all the years since 1968 that these members of the group and the family have faithfully met together and hoped, wished, prayed. And my story starts in the spring of 1968. And I was an instructor in the amphibious warfare school at Quantico, Virginia. And in those days, it's the mid-level professional course for all Marine officers. And in peacetime, it's a year long. But in wartime, it's divided up into fall classes and spring classes, or it was then. And it was the beginning of the spring class in 1968, and we joined a new officer, Major Ed Boyd. And Ed and I became friends, and he wanted to tell me he was just back from Vietnam, and he was just back from a tour of duty as the Battalion XO of 1-4. And he told me a story about Doug. told me especially how he had looked in Doc Long's eyes, looked in the platoon leader's eyes, obviously made having a thought process, a decision reached, and covered the grenade. It was not an impulse or a reflex. It was a deliberate laying down of his life for his friend. And Ed's wife died that spring, and that tragedy kind of erased most of my other memories of Ed. And at the end of that class, I went to Vietnam, and I was retired for disability after that, and our paths never crossed again. And I forgot almost everything he ever said to me, but what I couldn't, and I forgot Doug's name, what I couldn't remember, I mean, what I couldn't forget was the thought process. The fact that he looked in Doc's eyes, looked in the lieutenant's eyes, and did it. But it wasn't at the top of my awareness. It was back in foggy memory land. And 5.5 years ago, I came here to a book signing at the Christian bookstore. And a good friend, Bob Sharp, here, wanted to take me out and tell me all about this boy, Doug Dickey, who was received the Posthumous Medal of Honor and the only one in Dark County history. And he wanted to take me out to the cemetery, and I really wasn't particularly interested in going, but I didn't want to hurt his feelings, and so I said, sure, let's go. And he took me out to Doug's grave, and we took some pictures, and I noticed that Annie Oakley is buried about as far as from here to the display over there from Doug's grave and her husband. And on the way back, he kept telling me the story. And the more he talked, the more I had this strange feeling that I've heard this story somewhere before, but where? And he wanted to bring me in the museum. I really didn't want to go in the museum, but I didn't want to hurt his feelings. And so we came to the museum. And when I saw the display, I still didn't remember, but I had this feeling, this weird feeling that I've heard this story somewhere before. Well, I'll say, it wouldn't be an exaggeration, would it, General, to say thousands of Marines have covered grenades over the years?
Probably.
Hundreds, at least. But what made this one different was the thing about the eyes, to me. And so he kept telling me the story and talking about it. I looked at the display, and the people who were here at the time had done the best they could with what they had, but I felt that it needed to be better. And then it occurred to me, this could be the boy that Ed Boyd was telling me about in 1968. Well, I didn't know where Ed was. Our paths had never crossed again, but I went through Marine Corps circles and found he was a retired colonel living in Arizona. And I called him and asked him, and he said, yeah, that was Doug Dickey. And he started mentioning Bob Kelly's name and Dave Rumsey and these other names, the Dickey family. That's when I was hooked. That's when I knew I had to do what I could to make his display better, to make it more appropriate to the sacrifice and appropriate to the boy, the kind of man he was. And so I went on a quest to find another Medal of Honor. Well, as most of you know, posthumous awards, when it's a posthumous award, the family gets one medal, and that's all. If you survive, you get two, one to display at home and one to wear on appropriate occasions, such as this one. But there was no way, apparently, to get a second medal for Doug Dickey's family. But I kept trying, and I kept asking. And I traveled, I got to know people on the Medal of Honor Foundation in Charleston, South Carolina, and they couldn't help me. They didn't have a solution. And a good friend there, a mutual friend of General Livingston's and mine, is very much involved in the Medal of Honor Museum, which is also at Charleston. And he did everything he could and asked everything he could ask. And to shorten the story, we had hit the brick wall. There just wasn't any way to get one. And sometimes when General Livingston is traveling to one of his many, many speaking engagements, Carlisle, our mutual friend, goes with him to just accompany him. And on such an occasion, a little over a year ago, General Livingston said, and they were talking about me and talking about this quest for the second medal. And General Livingston said, you know, I'm not sure, but I think there may be such a thing as a for display only medal. And that was the key that turned the lock and caused the tumbler to fall, and the door began to open. I got to know the head of the awards branch at headquarters, Marine Corps at Quantico. And he said, yes, there is such a thing. And he told me exactly what to do and exactly how to do it. And we became friends. I mean, I didn't schmooze him up just to, you know, to be a manipulator. I liked him. I still like him. I'm going to see him the next time I go to Quantico and buy him something to drink. But he greased the skids, I'm sure, somewhat, which doesn't mean he did anything wrong. But in bureaucracies, if you know the right person, things happen faster. And the result was, how long ago did the medal arrive?
We received it probably about an 11-month process from now.
About 11 months ago, the medal arrived. And ever since then, the project has gone into high gear to make an appropriate display with the medal itself. Now, I dreamed about this ever since I realized that Ed Boyd had been talking to me about Doug Dickey. I've dreamed about the second medal and the new display. And what I dreamed of is not more than one-third of what you're looking at over here in the corner. Because Dave Mangus conceived it. He saw it in his mind. And Rusty put it together. He built it. He did the electronics. And the two of them, between the two of them, that's how this magnificent display. And I don't know about you, but I nearly faint when I look at it. And there's more than you can realize. You're going to have to study this thing and spend a lot of time to see every significant feature on that. And that's how I came to be involved, and I'd like to introduce Major General Jim Livingston, living Medal of Honor recipient, and from Charleston, South Carolina, who loves shrimp and grits as much as I do. And he is going to be our keynote speaker.
Let me again acknowledge the Dickey family and thank you for that service and sacrifice. As a Marine and a company commander who lost a lot of Marines in Vietnam, I sense a camaraderie here amongst all those brothers that served with him in Vietnam. And this brotherhood of Marines is one of the most significant things that I've ever experienced in the Marine Corps. I mean, you absolutely have a love, and I emphasize a love for one another. And to all the veterans, and I always say that 1% that's worn the cloth of this nation, I'd like to see your hands, just raise your hands, all the veterans that's worn the cloth of this nation. I thank you for your service and sacrifice. And to all the families, like my wife who stayed home, and so who kept the candles of home burning, you are just as much of that service and sacrifice. Amen. And I thank you very much for that. To all the friends, thank you for being here to remember a great American. And I'll get to my prepared remarks, but I've been looking since 1967 at photographs and books about Doug Dickey. And I looked at that photograph today, and it comes right back in my memory bank. A good-looking young kid with a most beautiful smile that you could probably ever look at. I mean, talking about a pearly-toothed young American, good-looking young kid. And I hate to use the term kid, Marine. It really just comes home and resonates with me. And it further, as I looked at that map today, it further resonated to me how close we were in terms of our locations in combat and almost in terms of being a special landing force, some of the most identical circumstance. That comes home. What really comes home is to think about during that time frame, not many Marines and any members of the service really rotated because they had finished their tour in Vietnam, which meant back in those days about 13 months that you had to be on the ground in Vietnam. Most of us were sent home because we were either wounded or, as they say, we had our third purple. The third purple meant when you got a third purple heart, you were allowed to leave country. And most of us rotated out of Vietnam because we had been seriously wounded, as I was, or we got the third purple. That's how intense it was and how difficult it was back in those days. But let me tell you one thing to be sure about the Vietnam War. You hear all the commentators and all the news media, and you hear all the stuff that was going on in the 60s. The Marines that I know were there because they love America, and they were there because they wanted to do their duty. Amen. And they would do it over again. And Doug Dickey would do it over again. He would absolutely do it over again. That's a testimonial to the greatness. That's the reason we're a great country. Amen. And as long as we don't have young 18 and 19-year-olds who are willing to raise that right hand and say, I do. As long as we have them, we're going to be a great country. We got warts, but we got greatness. And this greatness is amplified by what you see in that display. America at its finest. And that's the reason we're all here. We love who we are. We love America. But most of all, we love what Doug Dickey represented, the finest of the finest. Before I give you two speeches, I better get to my regular speech here.
We'll take both.
You know, I really, as I said, feel quite humble having been invited to honor POC Douglas Eugene Dickey. Douglas Dickey came from a very large, and is noted here, a very patriotic, all-American family. His surviving siblings we've mentioned today, his brother Dennis and Norman, were both Marines and Vietnam veterans, and his sister Vera are all here today. POC Dickey served, has been noted, in Charlie Company, 1st Battalion, 4th Marine Regiment. As a matter of fact, I can recall one night in Vietnam, just to get 2nd Battalion, 4th Marines off the front line, we relieved 1st Battalion, 4th Marines in a firebase position in Vietnam, and they went out on an operation while we occupied their foxholes. Would you believe it was a good deal to be in a foxhole that night and not be out and be in the weeds someplace? Let me tell you, that was a really a good deal for all you old Vietnam vets. Doug Dickey was born on December 24th, 1946 in Greenville, Darke County, Ohio. Like his father, who served in the long, brutal Pacific Campaign as a Marine in World War II. Doug also wanted to be, and Doug became an exemplary Marine. Doug Dickey was posthumously awarded the Medal of Honor for his actions on March the 26, 1967, in the Republic of Vietnam. In the heat of battle, PFC Dickey moved to replace a wounded radio operator. As the doc was treating the Marines, a grenade landed amongst all of them. PFC Dickey then made the ultimate choice, the ultimate choice of love. That choice was to give his life for his comrades. He laid down his life, just like Jesus Christ laid down his life for our soul. Doug Dickey did the same thing. He laid down his life for the soul and life of his fellow Marines. His selfless act is and always will be part of the legacy of this great Marine Corps. His name, Doug's name, appears on panel 17E, row 50 of the Vietnam War Memorial. The Medal of Honor, for information, aside from the Purple Heart, is the most easily recognized military award. Each of the three branches have their own version of this award. There's an Army version, there's a Navy version, which covers the Navy, the Marine Corps, and the Coast Guard, then there's an Air Force version. It is presented.